evening. Let's stand as we sing, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. All Southern gospel songs, sing it. Sing it like you know it.
Y'all do sound great. You look great, too. What a great crowd tonight, and I'm just so thankful that you're here. Thank you for being here, and I hope that God will just richly bless you tonight as we look at His Word in just a little while. I want to remind you of several things. Remember the Fields of Faith at BHP. The youth will be leaving the church at 6, so parents and grandparents, just remember about that, having your kids here Wednesday night for that. Also, deacons, remember, I didn't say it this morning, but you see it in the bulletins. There's a deacons meeting on Thursday at 7, so be here. If you're not going to be able to be here, I'm sure Tommy would like to know, so let him know that. Also, the other things we talked about, the John Delahaye Festival, if you'd like to do a trunk or treat, if you just sign your name over there, we'll leave it up for a couple of weeks just to make sure we get everybody that can do that, and we'll be giving more information in the coming days about that. I think everything else is in the bulletin, and I just want to say thank you. Connie and I took some time this afternoon, and I'm just so overwhelmed at just all the cards and reading each one, and I've got them on my desk now. I'm going back through them and reading them again. It's just such a blessing. I can't say thank you enough for all the gifts and the kind words of encouragement that are in there, and you just don't know what it means to me and means to Connie. It is such a blessing, and I'm the one that should be giving you all gifts because I'm the one that's blessed beyond measure. And I just thank God every day for just a wonderful church family. And I just thank you again for all those cards and all the things that are in there. And you'll be seeing, I just can't say enough and say thank you enough. But again, I just want to say thanks. I think that's all that we have as far as announcements. Is there anything else that you need to... anything that needs to be announced at this time? Just remember, on Wednesday nights when we come together, we do have a place for all kids, our children, mission from our young kids all the way up. So if parents, grandparents, bring them, we have our youth meeting, then we also have RAs and GAs for our children. So just make sure they're here and we've got places for them to be. So it's such an encouragement to see kids everywhere. As such, so just have them here on Wednesday night if you could, and they'll start at the same time at 7 with us. We'll go to our prayer time at this time, and as we prayed this morning, I want us to continue to pray for Israel. I hadn't watched much news this afternoon, so I don't know what's going on there, but we continue need to be praying. I think it's about 8 hours ahead, so it's probably in the morning there, so be praying that as they start a new day, that God would just bless that country and keep them safe. And our missionaries that we have there, and especially the one that we pray for every day, Herbie Gear, we want to continue to pray for him and his team. And then we also want to pray for, forget about Danny and Jordan. They'll be coming in, I think the last word I had from them will be coming in, I think, sometime in December. So be praying for them, and hopefully we'll get to see them while they're here. Also continue to pray for Adam and Corey Willard as they're there, and many others that are on the field. We want to just pray for them also. I want you to also, if you see, we have Miss Sarah Wilson's family. We want to pray for that family as Miss Sarah passed away this past week, and we also this morning was pray for Miss Dale. And we have a gentleman, Johnny Cox, that lives down the way. He had shared a name with us yesterday, a little harbor, and I can't think of the last name. He's like 5 or 6 years old, just very, very sick. And he texted me this afternoon and just asked if we would just remember that little one in our prayers today. So if you would just remember Harbor, the Lord knows who we're talking about, and we'll be praying for him also. And this is a good time. Is there any other prayer request or anybody that you want to just give us an update on at this time? Oh, no. So let's pray for Johnny Martin. Thank you. Want to lift him up? Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Well, let's remember Miss Bell. We sure will. Any others? Yeah, how is Kent? Good. Making a lot of little progress. Okay. Have they moved him from the hospital? Where are they? At the AnMed rehab? Okay. Well, we'll check on him. My dad got to come home a while ago, so be praying for him. It's going to be a long road. The doctors pretty much told him that he's going to continue to have these TIAs and the stroke type thing. Symptom. Matter of fact, he had one while we were getting him out of the car, and it was lingering a little bit longer than that we wanted. But I think there's going to be some decisions that's got to be made. So just be praying for Patsy and Leanne and Travis and myself, as we probably are going to have to really discuss what's, because Dad's going to need some extra help there. So just be praying for him too. And continue to remember Mark and Debbie, and I know there's many others. Remember Jennifer's brother, Sean, as I mentioned this morning. He is still not doing well, and Jennifer and Kim are out there in California. And also Eddie Scoggins, if we would continue to remember Eddie, as he's been having some heart issues and back and forth to the doctor, and I know that just needs our prayers. So if you just lift up Eddie in your prayers. And how about any others?
Richard.
Yes, sir.
I got a prayer report. And we was talking about it in my Sunday school class this morning. One of the things that was big in bringing us as a family down to this church years ago was that one of my granddaughters, when we first got her, adopted her, she had was diagnosed with 2 brain tumors.
Mm.
And this church done a lot of praying for her, and we didn't quite understand and everything, but without going into a big bunch of details, what I'd like to do is she celebrated her 29th birthday this week.
Hey, man.
And praise God, she still got those same tumors that hadn't changed a lick.
Really? Isn't that something?
They told us if she ever had to have them taken out, she wouldn't be able to talk or she'd have seizures.
Wow.
And God has just touched her. And we go a lot of times and don't even give it thought.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just, we take stuff for granted. And
that's
I just
right.
Want to thank God for what he's done for her.
Amen. And which one is that?
Ashley.
Ashley. I tell you what, sometimes, you know, the great physician is God, right? And he handles our bodies, and he takes care of all things. And I tell you what, it's just a wonderful thing, especially if people are going through things, to hear how God's worked in someone else's life. And he works in all of our lives and blesses us. And thank you, Dwight, for that praise.
19 years.
Wow. Thank you for that praise report. That is so good. I tell you, God is so good. My uncle, Dennis Bratcher, if you would continue to remember him, they moved him to Anderson Rehab over there at AnMed this week. And also Connie's uncle, Gerald, was moved there this week. So they're both there, and both of them have a long way to go. So pray for both of those also. They're on our prayer list. And any others before we go to the Lord in prayer? Unspoken. How about other unspoken requests? I know I've got some. Thank you. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll just ask his blessings and upon these requests in this service. Father God, we come to you tonight, and Lord, we just praise you for who you are. Lord, as Dwight just shared a praise report, Lord, of how you take care of things, and Lord, and Father, like he said, sometimes we forget about them or take them for granted, but Father God, you know all things, and Father, you just handle them the way that a Heavenly Father would. And Lord, we just thank you, Father, that we can come now and just lift up friends, family, Lord, people that we are concerned with, the names that you've heard here tonight. Lord, you heard each one, but Lord, you know the situation. You know what they need. And Father, we just pray a special prayer for each name and each one. We pray that the ones that need a spiritual touch, Lord, that you would just touch their bodies. The families that need healing touches, Father, would you just do a mighty work in their lives, that, Father God, that real soon they could be up praising you and giving testimonies as we've already heard. Lord, for wisdom that's needed in many situations, we pray for that and pray that your will be done. And Lord God, we just pray in a special way, Father, that you would just be with our brothers and sisters in Israel. Lord, we know that there's so much that's written in the Bible about that. And Father God, we just pray that, Father, that you would just, we know you're going to protect them. But Father, we just pray that even our leaders here in the United States, Lord, would be bold and stand firm and stand beside Israel, Father. And Lord God, we just pray also that you would be with all the others that have been mentioned here. We pray for our church. We pray, Father God, that you would open our eyes as we saw and talked about this morning. Open our eyes to the fields, Lord, that are before us and the harvest. And show us how we can take part in reaching those for Christ. Lord, thank you again for all the opportunities. Now we just ask your blessings upon the remainder part of the night. Lord, speak to us. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our God is faithful, right? Stand as we sing, standing on his promises. He promised it. Do it. It's an offertory hymn.
Standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. Lord, over this matter, we take up this tithe and offering, and use it up there in thy kingdom. Please, not a thing. Yes, in Jesus' name. Amen.
And Miss Fran, you might have to correct me, but I think our offering for Janie Chapman was over $5,000 this morning. Am I correct?
It's over $6,000.
Over $6,000 for Janie Chapman. Isn't that a blessing? What that is just wonderful. And all that money will stay here in South Carolina and do a mighty work. So
that was the Lord gonna be giving tonight. When do you want me to mail a check?
Let's get that money tonight and then we'll mail it this week, okay? God be the glory. Anytime this week, whenever you get a chance. That is wonderful. That is unbelievable. God be the glory. Come on, Miss Deb.
Well, it's me again. Miss Fran wasn't feeling quite up to singing tonight, so she asked me to sing, and thank you, Miss Fran. Aren't we blessed that we are covered by the blood of Jesus?
Amen.
And we are forgiven no matter what our sins. So that's what this song is about. Mercy Walks In. It's an oldie, but it's always a goodie.
lyrics.
These are just not the whole lyrics.
I was looking at her notes there. She does good. I wish I could preach off of something that small. That's good. And sound that good, too. That is very good. Thank you, Miss Deb. Aren't we glad God's mercy came to each and every one of us? It's Sunday night, and it's a good time for somebody to give a testimony. Anybody got one? Dwight's already shared one, and I'm sure if I put him on the spot, he could share again. There you go. Anybody got anything?
And I said, yes, man inspired by God. So he said, no, he said, it's not just ordinary men. And I said, well, he uses ordinary men in daily life to witness, like I'm doing to you. And he said, well, you can't convince me. And I said, okay, do you want to go to heaven? Do you want to go to hell?
Wow.
In hell, there's fire. You burn eternally down there. I said, wouldn't you rather go to heaven where you're going to walk on golden streets? And he looked at me and he says, no, he says, if I go to hell, I'll take my fire extinguisher with me. he said, when he got ready to leave, he says, do you want your walking stick back? And I said, no, sir. I want you to remember everything I told you.
Amen.
So
seeds were planted.
This is what I run across when I'm out on the field, but I am truly blessed for that.
And I'm sure most of you know that when she talking about these walking sticks, did y'all make 10,000 again this year?
And more.
And more.
I think there was 22,000.
22,000 walking sticks. I got one in my office that's got the plan of salvation on it, the little colored beads, and so it's good. So it's a walking stick, but it's also a walking testimony.
Yes,
so that's great.
I'll be going next week.
Next week. We'll be praying for Miss Diana. How about anybody else? I know somebody else is wanting to just shout out something. No?
I just praise God I can do this.
Amen. That is good. Fields of white harvest. We just got to see the harvest. Well, is anybody, tonight we're going to go week two of Fool's Gold. And last week we kind of talked about how the world what the world has to offer, and so many people are out there trying to fill their lives with the things of the world, and it's fool's gold. Well, tonight we're going to look at overcoming the challenges and seeking after God's wisdom. You know, that's what's so hard, just what Miss Diana just shared with us. In our world today, people think that they've got worldly knowledge and wisdom and things of the world that they've heard, and they have no facts. In God's wisdom, we have the facts. We have His Word. And it tells us the truth. And you know, that's what it is. And you know, when you start to think about it, when I think about fool's gold, I start thinking a little bit about people in hard hats working underground. Okay? When I start thinking about gold, these are people in hard hats working underground. And it comes to mind how gold is mined. I've never been to a gold mine or anything, but that's just what comes to my mind, and my mind's pretty simple, okay? But that's what I think about. But you know, I do know that it's challenging work, and according to what I read, it takes a long time from prospecting to mining to producing the finished product of refined gold. And you know, when you think about that, that's that way, but on the other hand, fool's gold is such a more common element, and it's easy to discover because of its abundance and the ease of finding it. And you say, where are you going with this, preacher? Well, think about this, if you would. In fact, during the gold rush days of the 1840s, many inexperienced miners believed that they hit the mother lode only to find out they had gotten nothing of real value. Isn't that true? I mean, the way I get all this is I watch those old westerns and all those old things, you know, and you see all these guys and they go, whoop. I look at this little guy that's got a big old hat, got these pants pulled up here with the boots up. Okay, y'all like my socks? The other night, I had to wear socks like that the other Monday night because the little boy was singing. He always dresses snazzy, and he always has those happy socks. So I wore my happy socks, and I didn't realize I had another pair of happy socks, but that I do, but I done chased a rabbit. Let me get back where I was going, okay? I'm sorry. Where was I on my happy socks? Oh, the little guys you think about these little guys, and they talk, or they've got a high voice, and they out there, but they think they hit the mother load, and it ended up being fake. And you know, that's what happened when we see that. But you know, when you think of that and we think about all of this, fool's gold has no value. No value at all. And the wisdom of God is different. It's a lot like what I call real gold. You see, in order to find the true wisdom of God, we must dig. How do you get down to the true deep where gold is? You have to dig deep. And so that's kind of where I think the wisdom of God, we must dig deeper than just a casual reading of the Word of God. You know, a lot of times I used to think, and I'm going to have to tell you, my daily quiet time consisted of open windows, reading a Bible verse, and reading a little story. And I didn't grow very deep sometimes, you know. And I think that's kind of where a lot of people get today, and our wisdom kind of stays where it's at. But this is why Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15 to be diligent in your study of God's Word, to be a worker when it comes to digging out the truths of God's Word. Dig it deep. There was a study done of 6,000 Christians by a Christian book distributor named Crossover. They found four things that hinder men, women, boys, and girls from being real workers when it comes to studying God's Word. How many of you are thinking right now what they might be? This study showed that here's what they were: not having enough time. I hear that a lot. I don't have enough time to study God's Word. Lacking of discipline. That's a big one. Feeling intimidated. I don't understand it. Intimidated. And struggling to apply the Bible to everyday life. This is what hindered a lot of people. So tonight, I want to kind of get into the message, and as I do, the message is kind of a challenge to us to dig deeper in our personal study time. You might have a great study time, and it might be, you might really get in there, and you open up, and you look through all the different things, but you know what? You can always do a little more. Go a little deeper. You see, I think what God wants us to do is to get in there and mine the riches that He has for us. You know, that word of life that He has. And I think if we do that, we can be assured that our life will be changed. There's not a doubt in my mind that if we get in and we spend the time and dig deeper into our God's Word, our life will be changed. It doesn't matter how good it is. If you're good and you're following God, that's great. But go a little deeper. And you see, I think that's where we want to go tonight. So how do we need to challenge ourselves to mine the treasure of God's wisdom? I want to kind of share with you three challenges and then the outcome if we're successful in overcoming those challenges. Our scripture text tonight comes from Job chapter 28. We're going to be looking at verses 20 through 28. And then starting in verse 20, it says, "From where then does wisdom come? And where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all living. And concealed from the birds of the air. Destruction and death say, 'We have heard a report about it with our ears.' God understands its way, and He knows its place, for He looks to the end of the earth and sees under the whole heaven, to establish a weight for the wind and apportion the waters by measure, when He made a law for the rain and a path for the thunderbolt. Then He saw wisdom and declared it. He prepared it, indeed He searched it out. And to man He said, 'Wisdom, and depart from evil is understanding.'" Tonight, I got like three or four points that I want to just bring out. But the point number one I want to tell you is, my challenge is not to say I don't have the time. I hope that's what I want to get tonight. I hope your challenge isn't I don't have the time. I don't have the time to study the Bible because we need to understand that God only gives wisdom to those when I need it. If I mean, anybody here, I tell you what, I was talking a while ago, the wisdom for my family, because there's some the decisions. And a lot of times in our lives, we have to make family decisions. And we say we need the wisdom, but a lot of times we're blinded by certain things that we don't really see what God really has in store, because He knows what tomorrow holds, right? And a lot of times we have to say, Lord, I need the wisdom. Now what we're saying is, Lord, not only the wisdom, but we need to see what You got before us or where we're going, because God knows all things. And I think right there, and we see in verse 23 where He kind of moves us that way when He said God understands its way. It says God understands its way and He knows its place, talking about wisdom. See, God tells us that I know where true wisdom comes from. That's what He says. God says that. I know where true wisdom comes from. Guys, that's what we need to be saying. Where does true wisdom come from? Does it come from the guy down the street, the guy you eat breakfast with, the woman you go have coffee with? Where does true wisdom come from? It comes from God above. And that's the place that we understand. The text we just read tells us that we don't know where it dwells. You know, so if we want true wisdom, we must get with God, and we do that through studying His Word. And that's why I tell you what, a lot of times I pray for those knuckleheads in Washington. I wish they had daily prayer time and Bible study for each one of them. They're seeking for wisdom, and they're looking in all the wrong places. I mean, I just know that. And they need to be looking and studying God's Word, and I guarantee you that there's a bunch of them up there. There's 102 senators and I don't know how many House of Representatives, and I guarantee you that probably less than 10% of them have Bibles in their office somewhere. Probably less than 1% ever open them up. And then we're letting them make decisions for us. But you see, true wisdom only comes from God in His Word. If we're not a Bible-studying Christian, we are receiving wisdom. And let me go back and say this, because we see this. If you're not a Bible-studying Christian, you're receiving wisdom. But it's not the wisdom of God. It is the wisdom of the world. Now, whose wisdom you want to listen to tonight? God's wisdom or outside those walls? Sitting in here, we want to say God. But when we get outside of those walls, what do we say? You know, we're getting our wisdom through television when we're not listening to God. Our television and news media is perverted. Anybody agree with that? I mean, we have let them just go crazy. But you know, a lot of times we get our wisdom from non-Christian friends. How many of you ever told your kids growing up, watch out who you associate with? Watch out who you associate with. And then we go and we get wisdom from non-Christian friends. Don't tell me you've never listened to somebody that give you some advice that we're not Christian. We're all guilty of that. But you see, that's where our wisdom comes from. And that's just a couple of ways that we get worldly wisdom and how it seeps in or kind of comes into our life. There's many more ways. James, in his epistle, describes that type of wisdom you're receiving from the world as earthly, unspiritual, and even demonic. Now, how many of you like to listen to the devil? James is telling us all that type of worldly advice is even demonic. Do you want demonic wisdom in your life? Do you? You do when you go out and you listen to what the world's got to say. See, we need to make sure we don't miss this. Each one of us is receiving wisdom one way or the other. I don't care. I'm just wanting you to make sure wisdom's coming to you one way or the other. We either receive the wisdom of God, which we are minded through the study of God's Word, or we receive the wisdom that is plentiful, abundant, and don't take much effort to get a hold of. And James calls it demonic wisdom, which is fool's gold. That's it. We always try to like to go get that easy advice. That easy to get wisdom. Siri, Where can I? Don't tell me none of y'all's never done that. Mr. Robert, I know you hadn't, okay? Go ahead and tell me you've never done it. Mr. Robert has not. That's the one, okay? But the rest of us are guilty. We like to check and get the easy way out. And it seems that most Christians are content with worldly wisdom. A research from the George Barna Group in March 2020 tells us that well over half of American adults, which is over 60%, never read the Bible in a typical week. And a full one-third of those identified as born-again Christians can't find time to read their Bibles. You and I as Christians cannot be content to let that worldly wisdom penetrate our lives. We must put in the time to study God's Word. We have to overcome the challenges of not having enough time. And I say that because that's the same excuse I use. I mean it. I don't have enough time. I got to go see such and such. I got to go do this. Man, I got to get the sermons ready. I say that. You say, well, Preacher D, you're studying. No, when I'm getting sermons ready, yes, God is speaking to me, but it's not my personal digging in time for wisdom a lot of times. So that's point one. We don't have enough time. But let me tell you, which brings me to point number two. My challenge is to discipline myself, and my challenge is for you to discipline yourself so we don't let anything interfere with our time studying God's Word. That's point number two. From where then does wisdom come? And where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all living and concealed from the birds of the air. So I ask you, how important is studying God's Word? Sitting in church, that's pretty important. We say that. Oh, it's pretty important. But the Scripture tells us, apart from God's Word, there is no way to get God's wisdom. Here's the thing. People, and we see it so much today, people say, well, I just want God's wisdom, and they never open the Bible. They look for other places. They never even open. The only place we're going to get God's wisdom is from God's Word. Listen closely to what the Scripture says there in verse 21. It is hidden from the eyes of all living. Apart from God's Word, apart from the Holy Spirit revealing the wisdom to me and you, we won't get God's wisdom. The Holy Spirit guiding us. We studied the Holy Spirit a few months ago on Wednesday night. The Holy Spirit is important to a born-again Christian. That's where we are guided and God fulfills. Our eyes can't see it. It's kept from the living, is what it says. But our hearts can feel it. Our hearts can see it because the Holy Spirit is speaking. You see, that's what we need to understand. So we must discipline ourselves to spend time in God's Word and allow His Spirit to speak through to me in its meaning. I'm going to tell you, when you open God's Word, and I can tell you from experience, and I can go out here and each one of you probably have an experience or a testimony to where you could say that you were searching, you opened God's Word, started reading it, and the Holy Spirit began to talk and speak. Is that amen? I see some heads nodding. And you see, that's going deeper, and that's when God's working. But we can't do it if we don't have enough time. When we let other things come in and we don't have the discipline to make what we need to. You see, let me ask you, this is what I say. How many of you here think earning a living to provide for your family is important? Everybody's going to raise your hand. I've seen this many times. I'm just saying from my own life, okay, my own experience. I've been sick over the weekend, missed church on Sunday. Come 8 o'clock Monday morning, where am I at? I'm going to make an effort to be at work. See, I'm disciplined, and I was so disciplined, I was going to work no matter what. We become so disciplined, we're going to show up at work even if we're sick. Now, I know I'm talking to the choir tonight, so I'm not fussing and saying this to you, but I'm just showing you how disciplined we got to be sometimes. A friend may go on vacation and ask you to take Thursday off and go fishing with him. You tell your friend, I can't go because I cannot miss work. But Sunday comes, a friend invites you to ride up to the mountains with him. What do you say? Sure, I'm missing church. See, we're disciplined not to let distractions keep us from going to work. But I'm afraid that our world and our churches and our Christians today are not disciplined enough to prevent distractions from keeping us away from God's word. Okay, that's my opinion, okay? But I really believe that. I want us to think about all the areas of our life that you're disciplined in. You're disciplined in your job. I think every one of us would say that. Hopefully you're disciplined about staying faithful in your marriage if you're married. I'm sure you're disciplined about cutting the grass in your yard on a weekly basis if you like your yard to be green and pretty and it's fixing to start turning brown. But a lot of times we get disciplined about doing yard work and keeping the house looking. I mean, we become disciplined in that. And I could probably go on and on with a lot more things that you're disciplined about. You kind of get my picture, don't you? And the point is, we can be disciplined because you're already showing by being disciplined in those things. You can be disciplined. You know, a lot of people say, well, I have a hard time being disciplined. I just cannot make myself do it. Well, you're lying. Because you make yourself be disciplined to do other things, right? And that's what's so sad. Sometimes we say we can't be disciplined about reading God's word. Well, it just ain't any fun. You know, it's never fun sometimes when the Holy Spirit has to try to get our attention to get us on track to where God wants us to go. See, our challenge in this world is to be spiritually disciplined. Point number two, which takes us and brings us to point number three. My challenge is not to get discouraged or to discourage you tonight, but when we're studying God's word, how do you feel? You see, how many of you have ever been studying God's word, been into a church service, and I've heard people tell me, I'm not going to church there because I just don't get nothing out of it. But you know, a lot of times, how many of you have ever felt like and get discouraged because when you're studying God's word, you feel like you get nothing out of the study? 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16 and 18, it kind of says something about the invisible. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us as far as more exceedingly an eternal weight of glory. Verse 18. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are not seen are temporary, which the things are seen are temporary. But the things which are not seen are what? Eternal. See, I don't believe the time you spend studying God's word is ever wasted. Even when we get up and say, I got nothing out of it, it's never wasted. Like I mentioned this morning, a testimony, harvesting, reaping is never wasted. Okay, whenever we're doing something for God, it's never wasted. Sometimes we might feel like we got nothing from studying the Bible, but that does not mean that God is not doing something inside of you. See, Paul in our passage a while ago says, I don't notice anything on the outside God is doing, but I know he was renewing me on the inside. That's the greatest thing about God. I wished he could change the outside of me sometime, because if so, I would look a lot more buffed. I'd have a lot more up here. I'd still get rid of some of this, even though I got rid of some. But thank goodness, inside, I look good, because he's changing me from the inside. You see, my Bible says, he who has begun a good work in me will see it until the day of completion. At that day of completion is the day I draw my last breath. See, that's what God's doing daily. I'm still breathing, so he's still working on the inside. I love the little song, and I can't sing it, but he's still working on me. See, that's it. I know the tune. You know, that's why I say, watermelon, watermelon, watermelon. I know the tune. I just want, But you see, he's going to be working on me to the day that I die. Because he has something. And it makes me be reminded that the challenge is not to get discouraged when I feel like God is not talking to me. And that's what I tell you tonight. When you feel like God's not talking to you and you say, well, I'm just not going to read anymore. It just doesn't feel like I'm getting anything out of it. Don't get discouraged. Because God is working. His word is planted in your life and will not come back void. It's planted in your life, and I've always heard this, and I truly, God's word never goes out and never comes back void. It goes when it moves. It is something happening because it's real and alive. God's word's alive. Which brings me lastly to point four I want to tell us tonight. The outcome. If I overcome the challenges and allow God's wisdom to wash over me, then I will live the type of life that is pleasing to God. And I will be at peace with God, with my fellow man. You know, when I think of that and that statement I wrote right there, that's true. When we let God's wisdom wash over us, and I say wash us, a lot of times God's wisdom has to clean us up a little bit. He has to get us in line with what he wants to. A lot of times God's wisdom isn't going to be going down the middle of the aisle like we want to go. God's wisdom might be bringing us a different way, doing something different. And whenever God makes changes, we have to be cleaned up a little bit because we're going to fight him and get dirty as we fight. I ain't doing that. Oh, yes, you are. You see, we need to be reminded that when we have to be washed and God's wisdom washes over us and he has to change us, but when we're in God's will, as I said this morning, when you're in the middle of God's will, not only are you pleasing him, but you're happy. There's a lot of people in our world today that's unhappy, and the only reason they're unhappy is they're not doing God's will. They're not pleasing God. And a lot of times we want to please God by just checking the box. If I check the box Sunday night, a lot of times I check the box and think God's going to be pleased just because I'm in church. Thank you. I'm pleased. Your preacher's pleased, okay? But God's not, he is excited that we're here. But what excites him more is when there's a change going on inside. When we're letting his word penetrate our heart and he's working in our lives, then we not only are happy, he's very happy, but we're at peace with the people around us. We live in a world today that is not at peace. We're talking about Israel. Why is the Hamas going after it? They hate them. There's no peace. There's no God. They're chasing some Allah. Some un-God that's never going to do anything for them. They're chasing greed. They're chasing their hatred. There's no peace. And anytime you got hatred, you're never at peace with God. And you're never at peace with your fellow man. Let me share a couple of scriptures with you. Job 28, verse 28, part of our text. And to man, he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And depart from evil is understanding. Now go back with me if you would, if you want to turn back or turn over in the New Testament to James chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Did you get that? Y'all write James 3, 17 and 18 down. Go back and read it some this week. Because wisdom comes from God above. And when we do that, we feel the peace, the gentle, the willing to yield, the yieldness of our life to him. See, both of these scriptures tell us the same thing. If I mind and follow God's wisdom, I will be at peace with God and at peace with my fellow man. Man, that's good enough for me. That's good enough for me. If I can be at peace with God and at peace with my fellow man by following his will, he gives me the wisdom that I need, then I need to be following that. I need to be finding it. And I'm not going to find it watching the news tonight. I'm not going to be watching it by watching a football game tonight, which I probably will. But I won't be looking for wisdom. I'll just be looking at something that I can be a Monday morning quarterback and say, that was a stupid play. But I'm just saying wisdom only comes from God's Word. And when we see that, there's something else that we need to understand. It's a great reward for overcoming the challenges of bringing God's wisdom into our heart. Each and every one of you sitting here tonight, I know that there was a time when you made that first move of wisdom, asking God into your heart, asking Jesus to come into your life, putting your faith in Him. That's wisdom. That's the smartest thing that you're ever going to do. Let me just tell you, there's a lot of things that you're going to do, but that's about as smart as you get right there. Miss Diana was just saying that guy rejected. That wasn't too smart. But I'm going to tell you what, when you do that first move, and then you begin to build on the wisdom that God gets you, but it only comes after that first move and that first acceptance. So I ask you tonight, when you see all these things and we look at all these things, where are you looking for wisdom? Where are you getting your wisdom from? Are you overcoming the challenges? You know, one of the saddest things that I hear, and even in my own life that I have done, is I feel like I fail. The same mistake over and over in my Christian walk. Because I lack the wisdom to overcome it. God gives me everything I need to be able to do what He wants me to do. But now I'm going to tell you what, He's a loving Father. And He wants us to grow. You know, it's just like our kids. We don't want our kids, even though I'd love for my kids to stay 3 or 4 some days. Now, after you've had your grandboys for a whole day, 3, 6, and 8, yeah, I can't wait till they grow up a little bit. I won't be quite as tired. But, you know, we do, and I think that's what our Heavenly Father likes to see us grow, getting in His Word, praying and talking to Him, and listening to Him through the Holy Spirit. And then you know what that means? That we're up to the challenge. We're up to the challenge to be mining for the real gold that only comes from Jesus. We're mining for the wisdom of gold, those golden nuggets that only come from God's Word. I know you've heard that before. There's some great golden nuggets in this book. A lot of great golden nuggets. But you're not going to find it by just highlighting it. You got to put your hat on and dig deep. Go down in the ground and find out what God wants. So tonight, as I close, and just ask, because everybody here tonight is Christian, okay? I don't want to take for granted that, but I just feel like everybody here, or you wouldn't be here on Sunday night. But are we growing? Are we gaining the wisdom? Are we getting it from God or getting it from others? Why is that? Are you digging God's Word and digging into God's Word and getting those golden nuggets? Or are you just taking the easy way out and checking the box? See, only you and God knows what He's talking to you about tonight, because the Holy Spirit's speaking to everyone in here one way or the other. He's speaking to everyone in here tonight. He's saying, hey, just keep doing what you're doing. I hope that's what you're hearing. Or He's saying, no, I'd love for you to dig a little bit deeper. Maybe change your tools a little bit. But whatever it is, I just ask you to do what God wants you to do. I'm going to pray, and if you need to just have me pray with you, I'd be glad to pray with you. But when I finish praying, you got a benediction? Or not an invitation, just a course. God is so good. We'll just sing God is so good. I'll be around. But I do challenge you this week to just dig a little deeper. There's a song, but I'm about to quit. I'm going to chase a rabbit. Less is best. But just dig a little deeper in God's Word and see what wisdom you gain. Father, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, we're not closing the service or closing the invitation. If someone needs prayer, you know that I'm always here, and they know I'm here, and we'll pray with them. Lord God, I pray as I'm praying right now that the Holy Spirit will be speaking to each one of us. Lord, I hope the Holy Spirit's giving us all thumbs up, saying, hey, you're doing good. Well, no, maybe you need to change and dig a little deeper. And if that's the case, Father, I pray that we'll look and see what's hindering us from studying your word, growing in your word, and being used the way you want us to be used. Thank you, Father, again, for all these that are here tonight. We pray, Father God, that a special blessing would be upon them. And Father God, as we depart from here tonight, Lord God, you'd help us in our eyes to see the fields which are white for harvest that we talked about this morning. And Lord, as you give us an opportunity to share, however you give us an opportunity to share, we'll not waste that opportunity. Thank you, Father, for loving us. Thank you for saving our souls. And thank you for a place that we're all going to be one day called heaven. And what a joy it is to say that. And we just ask your blessings upon each one, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.